Good afternoon and welcome back to the channel. So in this video, I'm going to talk about the risk in getting out of the market and what I'm looking at personally and what these large financial institutions, whenever they decide to put down a big position in crypto and Bitcoin, what that's going to look like, how much assets they have under management, and comparing the amount of assets they have under management, even looking at 0.5% to the amount of money that we've seen put into Bitcoin over the last 2 months and what that has done to the price. So here is the agenda for this video. This is not financial advice, by the way. I'm not a financial advisor. We're going to go over the health of the market. We're going to go over some on-chain data. We're going to talk about these large asset managers and what that would potentially look like, and why getting out before that happens would be very risky for me. Again, not financial advice. And then we're going to go over leverage and flash crashes really briefly, just so I can elaborate on that a little bit more, because it's very important. And then just, you know, number four, anything is on the table. You know, we are on the precipice of mainstreaming cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, and blockchain technology. Now, mainstreaming is a spectrum, and there's different stages throughout there. But, you know, this could go into a lull for a period. This could absolutely explode over the next 6 to 8 months. Nobody knows. And because of that, getting out of it before that happens, in my opinion, is a big risk. So one that I'm not willing to take, but again, make your own decisions. So this is from Will Clemente, and this is his new, their new YouTube channel. It's called Blockware Intelligence. I highly recommend you go look at this. And the reason why I'm so big on-chain data is because technology has evolved. We have better technology now to analyze the health of a market. And you know, there's no reason to wonder what's going on in the market, because you can plug into the on-chain data and look at it for yourself. So this is a very, very important graph. Whales have now added 184,000 Bitcoin to their holdings in the last 2 months. This is a major statistic. This is 1% of all Bitcoin. When you take out whatever Satoshi owns and when you take out the Bitcoin that hasn't been created yet, this is 1% of the available Bitcoin. Whales have added to their holdings in the last 2 months. Now, another part of this is we were down the previous 2 months, or maybe a month and a half. We were down this whole period. And all of a sudden, right towards the end of July, it just shot up. So that's very interesting. Why would they all of a sudden start buying Bitcoin right at the beginning of August, end of July? Something to keep an eye on. But 8.8 billion, remember this number, because we're going to compare this to these large asset managers and how much money they have as far as assets under management. 8.8 billion when you're looking at a 48K Bitcoin price. So even if you just want to do the average and run that back to 40K, you're still talking, you know, maybe over 6 billion, 6.5, 7 billion, something like that. That's how much has been bought over the last 2 months. And this is what that looks like on a graph. So this is from George. Also highly recommend you subscribe to George's channel. I do have some issues with certain things that George says. That being said, I feel like in a general sense, he guides his people in the right direction when it comes to diamond handing, never panic selling, continuing to dollar cost average. So I am a fan in that sense, even though I don't like a lot of the common narratives that get pushed on his channel along with some of the other channels. But in a general sense, I'm a fan of George. This shows the Bitcoin exchange exchanges reserves. So this is just absolutely cratering over the last 2 months. Look at this. And we've been over this before, but it's worth repeating, because that's what this is. When all of these Bitcoin are being purchased by these whales, and I'm sure retail's been buying as well, that's what it does to the supply. And at some point, exchanges run out of reserves. So, and the lower that this gets, the more likely that we're getting closer to that point. So very important to keep an eye on this. The same thing is happening with Ethereum. Over the last 2 months, you can see the exchanges just gradually going down. Stock to flow. Now, George did this video in response to BitBoy's tweet that he put out. If you did not see that, he's calling for the cycle top within about 3 weeks from right now. And, you know, basically just said, take all your profits off the table. You know, we're right on track, cycle top in a few weeks. And then I guess, you know, I guess global adoption is going on pause for the next 3 years. But I'm not really going to get into too much of the tweet, because I've addressed that stuff on other videos. But this is the supply on Ethereum continuing to go down. And if you've noticed, all of the Ethereum's competitors have been pumping. Like, we saw Cardano pump, we saw Algorand pump, we saw Solana pump, we've seen Avalanche pump, we've seen them all pump individually. It's like one pumps has their correction, and then the next one pumps. And like they dominate the news cycle for a few days while they're pumping, and then the next one happens. And we're seeing this at the exact same time where supply on Ethereum exchanges, or the Ethereum exchanges, where the supply of Ethereum on exchanges is continuing to go down over the last 2 months. This is stock to flow. And this was in reference to, you know, BitBoy calling the cycle top. And this is where we are. Look at the previous blow off tops in the previous cycles. Okay. And we're seeing adoption at a rate that we've never seen before. And to think that we're done at this point right here does not align with all the other available information, including the Bitcoin logarithmic growth curve. You can see the other cycle tops. And again, I'm not necessarily referencing previous cycles as in this cycle is going to be like those. I'm just saying that considering that we're seeing adoption at a level that we never have before and that whales are buying aggressively right now, you would assume that we would see something close to what we've seen in the past as far as reaching a particular metric for the overall price. But you know, this is where we're at right here. And it looks like we're about halfway, right? Or however, you know, halfway up based on the logarithmic growth curve. So we'll see what happens in that regard. But I just wanted to show you the on-chain data because I think that it's important. And I think that it should be taken into consideration when evaluating the overall health of the market. Now, this is the big part that I wanted to get to. I showed you where $8.8 billion were bought in the last 2 months from whales. And look at what that has done to the price. We're at 47K and we were at 29K. So you're looking at roughly, what is that? I mean, that's over 50%, well over 50% increase in the last couple months. And look at the amount of buying that did that. And we're still at all, like 3-year lows as far as the supply on exchanges. It's not like exchanges have even gone back out and increased the supply that they have available to sell. So we still have 3-year lows on exchanges. And we've still gone up over 50% in the last couple months with the amount of buying with that $8.8 billion, including whatever retail was buying. But this is the amount of money that they have as far as assets under management. BlackRock has $9 trillion of assets under management. So why am I going over this? All of these, all 10 are into cryptocurrency in some shape, form, or fashion. All 10 largest asset managers in the world, period. Now, some are more bullish than others, but I could have run a list of the top 100, top 200, because whenever this starts to move forward, there's not going to be like maybe 20% of them get in. If this is ultimately determined on a massive scale, okay, this is the future, which I believe that it is. It's just a matter of when they decide to make their moves, because I think everything is going to be highly controlled and they're making very strategic, calculated moves as far as when they put these big positions down. But look at how much money that they have. And if you're just doing basic numbers here, this is just the top 10, $41 trillion of assets under management between them. 3% of that would be $1.23 trillion. And Bitcoin only has a $900 billion market cap. 1% of that would be $410 billion. And a half of 8% would be $205 billion. Now, the reason why I wanted to highlight this half of a percent only with the top 10 is because look at what happened with the $8.8 billion that's been spent in the last two months. It's gone up over 50% from that 29K. So it's gone up over 50% with that 29K, from that 29K with only 8.8 billion. But look at just half of a percent of the top 10 would cause the price to go nuclear. And you have to add on top of that all the other buying that is happening from everyone else. And you have to take on top of that, that the exchanges are at 3-year lows. So this is my concern. I look at this like a ticking time bomb, and we're on a timeline here, is that we are right here today. Now, this is 2023, call it 2024. I'm just trying to give a diagram to talk about my mindset when I'm looking at this. At some point, this highlighted part is going to happen. Now, you could debate on when that's going to happen. I don't know when it's going to happen. I'm not even going to speculate when it's going to happen. But I feel pretty confident that it's going to happen at some point in time. So when that happens, I am not taking the chance on being out of the market, period. Not taking the chance. It's just, it's too much of a risk being out of the market and then trying to get back in before something like this happens, because nobody knows when this is going to happen other than them. And I believe that whenever, you know, I think the next 6 months, the next 12 months, the next 2 years, as far as this market and where we're at, as far as general price, has already been planned and already been calculated and figured out. You call me a cynic, but when trillions of dollars are on the line, I don't think that things like that are left up to chance. I think that things like that are well thought out ahead of time to prevent any type of global economic event that could ultimately cost them billions, trillions of dollars. So at some point, these main huge, huge players are going to put down very large positions. And here we are today. And I am going to accumulate everything I can from today until this happens. And that's my mindset. So here's Rick Ryder talking about, you know, why he keeps a moderate long position in Bitcoin, and I own a small piece of Bitcoin. And I do think more people are going to enter the fray over time. We have a very moderate position in our portfolio. I like volatile assets that have upside convexity, and I can see Bitcoin, like it's done, I could see it go up significantly. You know, so they bought $383 million in two Bitcoin mining firms, which is something to keep an eye on or pay attention to moving forward, through their mutual funds and exchange traded funds to support Bitcoin exposure to their clients. So to support exposure to their clients, $9 trillion in assets under management, they bought almost $400 million in Bitcoin mining firms. That being said, what happens when they actually go out and purchase Bitcoin directly for their clients, right? So that's why I really want, you know, keep in mind, this is going to happen. And when this happens, it's over for retail. We're never going back down to these prices. The days of buying cheap crypto is over. You can still buy. We can still buy. We can find lower cap alts that might have up a whole lot of upside. But as far as our purchasing power, it is over when this happens. That's end game, done, finito. And, you know, we'll have periods where there's lulls or corrections or periods where we level out. That being said, we'll never see these prices again, ever. Given how the Bitcoin price has risen, Ryder probably wishes BlackRock had made the move last November when he predicted Bitcoin would largely replace gold. So that's coming from the guy, the chief investment officer at BlackRock, that has $9 trillion of assets under management. Here's the article about Fidelity lobbying the SEC for a Bitcoin ETF. Keep in mind, a physical Bitcoin ETF and a Bitcoin futures ETF are two separate things. Physical Bitcoin ETF would hold Bitcoin and track its price. This is from CNBC. And the futures Bitcoin ETF would track Bitcoin futures contracts. I think both would cause the price to go up. That being said, if the physical Bitcoin ETF gets approved after the futures, just keep in mind that will, when the physical Bitcoin ETF gets approved, there will be actual Bitcoin that backs that ETF. So there will be very large purchases, and Fidelity already has this out there, and they have $4 trillion worth of assets under management. So what do you think that Bitcoin purchase is going to look like? Very important to keep an eye on that. For me, what I'm looking at, there's no risk of losing what I've accumulated. Solely talking about the amount of tokens and coins that I've accumulated, there is, you know, there's obviously the price fluctuates every single day, but I've invested roughly 20,000. My overall portfolio is probably around 27,000 right now. I'm prepared for that to go down to 10,000. I'm prepared for it to go down to 8,000. Right. And I'm just going to buy and accumulate down there, dollar cost average, and get my cost per token down. And that's what my plan is. So, and if it doesn't do that, well, then I'm very glad that I ended up staying in the market. So there is more potential upside if I sell and buy back. So the reason that I drew this graph was, let's say I do sell right here and it drops all the way to 20K. I sell at 100 and it drops all the way to 20K. In that scenario, I will probably be able to accumulate more and acquire more tokens and coins if that plays out exactly like that. I sell at 100 and it drops all the way to 20. That being said, what if I sell here, it pulls back to 80 and then checks down to 70 and consolidates, and then this happens. And after that, it's bye-bye, see you later, and straight vertical, never seeing cheap Bitcoin or cryptocurrency ever again. So that's really what I'm looking at. If I sell and buy back, like in the first scenario, there is risk of losing what I have accumulated. And that is my biggest concern, a risk that I'm not willing to take when you have these potential purchases sitting out there from these massive asset managers who are currently, well, at least Fidelity is, are lobbying the SEC to get an ETF approved. Very important to keep an eye on that. So the bottom part here is, this is from Bloomberg. I've mentioned this over and over again. This is recently, this is last month. Bitcoin surge lacks extreme leverage that powered previous cycles. So this is very important. Why is this important? Because the more leverage that you have in the market, the more unstable the market is, and the more they can drop it off of a cliff. But even from Bloomberg and all the on-chain analytics say the same thing. What we have seen over the last 2 months, it's almost like there is an intentional effort to liquidate long positions as we continue to climb. That is a great, great thing. And that would be an indicator of the fact that we're probably not going to be seeing any major, major crash, because they would have to sell so much Bitcoin to do that. But if the market is heavily over leveraged, they wouldn't have to sell that much Bitcoin, just far enough down to this line right here to where stop losses, liquidations kicked in, and then boom. But the very same 50K Bitcoin, and this is from Bloomberg, and all on-chain data backs this up. You could be looking at a 50K Bitcoin 4 months ago and a 50K Bitcoin today, and they could be entirely different as far as the health of that market, depending on how much leverage that 50K Bitcoin is sitting on top of. So this is very important. Please keep an eye on this. It does not get discussed enough. Leverage in the market does not get discussed enough. And it's one of the most important factors when you're judging the health of the market, because they can't just snap. They want to make people believe that they can snap their fingers and drop the price of Bitcoin by 80%. But if they do not have the sellers and there is not enough leverage in the market, they can't drop it like that. They can with these altcoins. They can snap their fingers and make some phone calls and drop it by 80%. You know, because of the way that those tokens are priced out through liquidity pools, but they cannot do that with Bitcoin if they don't have the sellers to do it. So that is very important to keep an eye on. That's all I have for this video. I wanted to try to make this as short as I possibly could. It was probably still too long, but all important information, I feel like. That is why I am not getting out of the market, no chance whatsoever. But I do believe there's going to be a big push. There's going to be a lot of propaganda coming out through mainstream media, through social media. Hey, so take this profit, take this, take that. We're going to, you know, there's going to be FUD. When I say anything is on the table, I think that there will probably have some type of crazy FUD that comes out that tries to shake people out. I am prepared for anything, and I'm going to continue to watch the main indicators. How much leverage is in the market? Are whales buying? Are they accumulating? What does that look like? And just in general, the other factors that we know are happening behind the scenes, the amount of mass adoption that we've documented very well on this channel. And, you know, I'm prepared for anything, but now until whenever, I'm going to continue to accumulate. As when altcoins are down, I'm buying. I've been buying over the last couple of days. I probably spent like $1,500 over the last few days. I'm panic buying at these levels, right? More AMP, more Polygon, more Terra, or some Terra. I finally got into Terra. And what's the other one? Anchor Network. I've got my Anchor Network position up to $1,000. So I'm thrilled about that. But I wanted to go over these main points. And yeah, that's all I have for this video. Let me know if you have any thoughts in the comment section below. Let me know if I got anything wrong, if I need to go back and correct anything. Thank you, everyone who has liked, shared, and subscribed. Take care. I'll see you in the next video.